Hi there, welcome to Meet the Leaders. I'm David Smith. We're in Hartford and we're catching up with the last third of the shortened session. And we're pleased to have Senator Bob Duff of the 25th District in Norwalk and Darien. It's good to have you with us. How are you?
Great. I'm doing great. Thank you.
Pleasure to have you here. It has been a busy time already for a shortened session. You've got to compact all kinds of things in that shortened session, like appropriations bills and things like that.
Well, if people can actually remember back to all those snowstorms that kind of knocked us off our game for a couple days, so it made a short session even more compacted.
That's right.
To get things done. But you know, I think everything's fine. We're on schedule and on time, and I think we'll be done on May 7th as we're supposed to be.
Well, and in talking with the controller and the governor and so forth, that $500 million is not pipe dream. It really is bit in the black for the first time in a long time.
Yeah.
Going forward, can you project that we're going to have that kind of a luxury in years to come? I mean, it's wonderful for 1 year.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we've gone from the worst per capita deficit to a surplus over the course of 3 years. And let me just remind people, too, that it's not just about extra taxes coming in. It's really about controlling spending as well. We have less state employees now than we did 3 years ago under the last administration. Our rate of growth is smaller than it had been in past administrations. So we're doing a lot of, and the governor especially is doing a lot of number crunching and cost containment and really trying to make departments and commissions live within their means and even less than that. So he's really making them sharpen their pencils, which is good. So, you know, we've had a lot of unexpected costs such as Medicaid costs and other types of things. When the economy goes down, people come to the government for safety net kinds of services. Those are hard to control. But from the standpoint of controlling other costs that we can, we've really, I think, done a good job of keeping the rate of growth a lot smaller. So now we have that. Really, to answer your question about what can we do in the off years, you know, to help make sure that we have those surpluses, is we can create those jobs, grow jobs, expand the tax base. That's really what our role is to do, is to expand the tax base and to have those jobs come in from, you know, organically come in the state of Connecticut, or have them come in from other places such as New York, New Jersey, other parts of the country. I mean, we've had a company called HomeServe in Connecticut that had their presence in Florida that it's now in Connecticut, in Norwalk. We had Jackson Labs that was going to go to Florida. They're in Connecticut now. We have Datto that just expanded.
Well, this is a brand new revelation, Datto thing.
These are really great jobs that are over $100,000 a year jobs on average in Norwalk. So, you know, I've known another company that I helped bring from New York that's in Connecticut that's going to be in Stanford. That's over $100,000, probably $200,000 a year.
These are examples of, you know, a lot of people say, all right, so you're offering somebody $5 million or $10 million to stay or to come here or whatever it is. So what do we get for that?
Right.
The Datto deal is around $5 million or so. And some of it gets forgiven if they hire on enough people and keep them on and so forth. It's a pretty complex equation that gets worked out.
Right.
But if you get 250 jobs out of it,
well, there's good. You know, there's built-in incentives, and then generally what happens, especially hopefully a company like Datto, is they end up hiring way more than we even expect them to hire, and again that expands the tax base that we have. So we have income taxes, sales taxes, property taxes for the city. We have more people who are shopping in the community, so I think it becomes a win-win. I mean, you don't do that for everybody, but you make sure that it makes sense. But on the other side of things, with our small businesses, we have the Small Business Express program that's helped over 1,000 companies in the state of Connecticut. That's helped to employ 14,000 people. So, I mean, without that partnership really with small businesses and helping to give them that extra push to make those investments, we may not have seen 14,000 people have those jobs.
It has been an incredible turnabout. We added to the unemployment rolls 3 months ago, and then a flip in a month, dramatic flip. Statistics are a wild game.
Right, well, some of it's weather. Some of it has to do with the fact that actually the places where we're constricting is in government. So we continue to shed jobs in government, whether it's local or state, and that does have an effect on the unemployment number. But I think private sector, we're growing faster than we've grown since the mid-1990s. I think that's great news.
No question about that. One of the aspects of this that's half a billion dollar in the black is the $55 per person under $200,000 rebate. A lot of people are you know, saying, this is an election year gimmickry.
Right.
You know, what is it really doing for anybody when $150 million, which is what it adds up to, plus 1.7 in costs, could go to that rainy day fund, could go to pension situation, could go anywhere where there's right. debt in the state of Connecticut, right. and there's plenty of that.
Right, well, don't forget, we are paying down our debts.
Right.
We are putting money.
$150 couldn't hurt.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we have to make decisions.
Yeah.
We already have money in our rainy day fund that was completely dried up a few years ago.
Sure.
We are fully funding our pension plans that we haven't done ever over the last 3 years. We've done that and I expect to do it this year again. We're saving through the agreements that the governor made with the state employees a few years ago, about $22 billion over the next 20 years in healthcare costs and pension costs. So those are real dollars that we're saving. And I think what the governor feels is that you know, people should, there was shared sacrifice. Now you want to have some other kind of, where we share a little bit of the good news that's out there. And that people do get it. Now, look, for some people, you know, $55 isn't a lot of money, and they're going to say, I don't need that, you know, the government should keep it.
Everybody needs it, but it's where it's needed perhaps.
There's some people who, I've talked to people here at the Capitol who don't get paid a lot of money. They say, you know what, $55 is going to really help me. It's going to put some gas in my car, or it's going to help me buy some groceries. Now, that's people who work here at the Capitol who have health insurance, who have, you know, may do a little bit better than some mm-hmm. other people. Mm-hmm. I know there's lots of places. I think about places like in Eastern Connecticut, Bridgeport, South Norwalk in some places. There's families who are struggling all the time. I mean, you think of our food pantries in South Norwalk. There's a lot of people who are using those food pantries because they're struggling, and there's more and more and more of that. So would those $55 be helpful to them? I think it would.
Well, it sounds... The governor seems determined to
He's
work
very
that,
determined
so
about it, yeah.
we'll see.
But I do believe in paying down our debts. I think that first and foremost, that is extremely important to do. And then you can take a little bit of it and maybe help our residents, because don't forget, you know, in some parts of Fairfield County, we live in, you know, a gilded area where things are okay, but there's an awful lot of people still struggling.
No,
you know, people
about.
Say the recession has ended, but it hasn't ended for everybody, so we want to try and help as many people as possible.
And energy and technology. Energy is an area which we have really been struggling this year. The cold temperatures have meant that everybody's oil and gas bill has been skyrocketing. The electric scenario has been just a nightmare with these providers playing all kinds of adjustable games with people's bills that you don't find out about right. until after the fact, mm-hmm. when that bill was $120 is all of a sudden $300
right.
and so forth, and then you have difficulty in getting out of it.
Right.
Tough
right.
scenario.
Right. Well, I've always warned people about those variable rates because they seem very consistent for a long time, and then with the winter that we had, it makes prices spike.
Yeah.
So there's a couple reasons why that we've had these spikes in prices. One is the polar vortex. I mean, having extreme cold weather, which has really been difficult for a lot of people this year. Second has been the fact that we have gas capacity issues. And what does that mean? I try to explain to people, I'm like, well, that means that, think of I-95 going southbound in the morning. There's just way too many cars for the highway, and you just not enough space to get people through. That's kind of like our gas lines. Because of the comprehensive energy strategy that we passed last year, we're going to be increasing those gas lines, and we already have one out of the three companies, probably two out of three companies, going to be doing that. We pay about 25% more for gas than New York City does because of those gas capacity issues. That's been a lot of the reason why energy prices have spiked.
Now, apparently, the consumers are going to be paying for those lines, not the shareholders.
No, it will be. It'll be through the companies and ultimately investments and those kinds of things, but it has to go through a number of different regulatory agencies for that to happen. Now, secondly, but what can we do better to make sure that people are more informed and we have a little bit more disclosure there? So we have Senate Bill 2 this year, which is the committee's highest priority, and trying to have more disclosure, put our arms around bad business practices, get the kind of the shysters out of the business. And because for years we didn't have anybody really get involved in a retail supply mix, meaning that consumers weren't very interested. We had a few companies. All of a sudden, a lot of new retail suppliers came in. We think that's good for the state. But when you don't have all the proper parameters, and we've watched this closely over the years. We never had the problems that we had until this year. We decided that we needed to step in and act and make sure that we tighten the controls that we have, because we do have pretty good consumer protections, but we do need to make sure, especially with those variable rates, that people are informed, they know what's happening. If they're going to change, that they're properly informed about that, and they can move on to either a different supplier, go back to the CLMP
and UI
price.
Because typically it's taken 2 months.
Yes,
by then you're hit too hard.
Right, and that's in our legislation to be able to do that.
How about solar? Yeah. How are we doing with that?
We're good. I mean, our investments in clean energy over the last 3 years is 10 times more than it was under the previous administration. And a lot of that is because of the fact of the work of the legislature and the governor. A lot of that is also because we now have a Department of Energy with environmental protection, which we had not had before. We redid our renewable portfolio standard, which again to the viewers may not mean a lot, but that means that we're going to be procuring wind energy from Maine, that's coming into Connecticut, that's going to be part of our total package in the state. That's coming in about 7 cents a kilowatt hour, which is about the penny more than the price of fossil fuels. That's a great price, because what we've done is we've put this out competitively, we've made these companies sharpen their pencils, and frankly, the 7 cents price might even be better at some point than even the fossil fuel price. So that's going to be a long-term contract for us in the state of Connecticut.
And that'll be starting when?
They have to build the line. It'll be coming in a few years. So it's not tomorrow, but it's now that we've procured it, they now have the ability to now build this line. Secondly, the six governors of New England have signed an agreement, which is great news because it allows for energy, which allows us to work regionally, imagine that, to have better transmission lines coming from Maine all the way down to Connecticut and greater cooperation, and also capacity, like gas capacity lines that are coming from various places, whether it goes south to north or north to south, or east to west, which should hopefully stabilize things too. So those are good news. So, you know, I don't want consumers to think that it's all, you know, 10, 20 years from now. But it is moving very rapidly. And don't forget, we did the Comprehensive Energy Strategy, which were our goal over 10 years is to have 200,000 consumers and businesses, residents and businesses, sign up for natural gas, which is could save people 55%, up to 55% on their energy bills over the summer, their heating bills.
Well, moving rapidly, transportation is a key for
Huge.
You, I know, and we've been focusing a lot on Metro North and the difficulties that they've had. They've got new leadership there. They are focusing now on safety first and on time second. Even when it wasn't focusing on safety, on time was taken a second.
Yeah.
Are you happy with what's going on there? And only a couple of moments, unfortunately.
No, I'm not, because I want them to do more, and I want people to have confidence in the train system. We have to view this as an economic development issue. We don't have good, consistent train service. We don't grow our tax base. We don't grow jobs in the state of Connecticut.
What can you as a legislator do?
Well, we need to work with them. We need to all row in the same direction. Individually, each legislator, not a whole lot, but I've been in touch with the chairman of the MTA, the president of the MTA, the chief of staff of the MTA down the line. We're in constant contact about what we all can do together to improve service and what we can do to bring confidence back to the MTA and the railroad, because that's exactly what our consumers want, that's what our constituents want, and that's how we're going to grow jobs in this state.
And that's what the state needs. Hey,
absolutely.
Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you.
Always good
Thanks
to see you. Senator Bob Duff, 25th District, our guest on this edition of Meet the Leaders from Hartford. Lots going on here. That's all the time we've got for this one. I'm David Smith. Thanks for being with us. We'll catch you next time.